So I'm going to go over some of these stress treatments now. First is thermal stress, and it's typically performed on solid samples. The mechanisms of degradation can be complex, but I think it's fair to say where you have labile bonds, that's where you're going to be affected. And it is most directly relevant to real-time stability studies. When you look at stability study design, it covers different temperatures over time, as well as humidity, and sometimes light exposure. It depends on, again, the design. Thermal stress is additive with other stress treatments, simply meaning you might subject a sample to acid in solution type of treatment, and you might go with ambient and a higher temperature. And you could exacerbate the stress of the acid due to heat. There's a model called the Arrhenius equation, which can be used for fine-tuning degradation. I'll say more about that later. But it has to do with something every 10 degrees that you increase your exposure temperature, you can, in theory, double the degradation. And you could play with that concept accordingly. Never fail to take advantage of DSC or thermographic and gravimetric analysis data that can reveal properties such as melting point, decomposition, and sublimation, which can influence your temperature limits. And you want to be careful that you know that sublimation is happening, because generally speaking, when you degrade a sample, you want to account for degradation product peaks. And if you're subliming, your material is just going away, and there's going to be a failure to get mass balance. So the next stress treatment to talk about is humidity. And I think we all know what that is. It's a key parameter in real-time stability studies, as I mentioned before. It's typically combined with thermal stress, and hydrolysis is the most likely mechanism of degradation. One can create high humidity environments for forced deg studies in a number of ways. You can use stability chambers, or you could create your own. I'll show that on the next slide. And consider the relevance of actually submerging your material in water. I mean, that's the ultimate humidity exposure, and it's valid and reasonable and scientifically sound. Okay, saturated solutions. I titled that slide accordingly because you want to create a microenvironment, let's say, for forced degradation. I like 55 degrees and 80% relative humidity. It seems to hit things just right, and it's easy to attain. So what we do is we use a typical oven that is set at 55 degrees. We would have a control 55 sample, call it dry, sitting out here somewhere in a vial. And then for your humidity add-on, you would put the samples into a desiccator, which it's not intuitive. A desiccator keeps things dry. In this case, we're just using it as a convenient chamber to put samples in. It's convenient also because there's a reservoir at the bottom where you could put in saturated salt solutions such as potassium chloride. This table is not intended to be read for its fine print, but it illustrates that these physical property tables exist where you can find a combination of salt and temperature, and you'll get the desired humidity. So hence, saturated potassium chloride gives you 80% humidity at 55 degrees. And that's how you can stress a sample there. Now, I'm going to not get into heavy chemistry here, but acid and base stress typically deal with hydrolysis mechanisms. And some label bonds are described here. And when you look at oxidative stress, there are similar descriptions as to how hydrogen peroxide or other forms of oxidation can facilitate changes in your material. We typically work with hydrogen peroxide. I've always been anxious to try out hyperbaric or bubbling oxygen through samples, and that's something I'd like to do because that seems more close to home. But peroxide is really what the industry does do at the moment. Freestyling. It sounds like the least likely stress, but you know it has more significance probably with macromolecules, and you think about proteins denaturing in solution. However, I could tell you from firsthand experience, I've seen freeze thawing affect a solid in terms of degradation. Never understood the mechanisms, and in fact, the chemists were baffled. This is a previous job, but just to say that you always want to consider the possibilities. And if nothing else, you cover all your bases when you're working with freeze thaw, because it could be a condition of abuse to a sample. Excuse me. So then there's light exposure, also known as photostability or photolysis. and it's looking at the stability of your component as a function of light treatment. There are ICH requirements that actually state what type of exposures you should have for both UV and visible ranges, and they're listed here. There are two guideline options for such exposures, and I wasn't really going to read them in detail except to say that we use a xenon lamp and we follow option one. What these do is they suggest a range or how to attain that range of wavelengths going from UV to the top of the visible spectrum. The Regis approach is that we use a photostability chamber. And this is sometimes talked about as a glorified light box with a timer. But it actually has a high-intensity xenon lamp that covers the desired wavelength ranges. It is adjustable by time versus irradiance so that you can go with longer time, less irradiance, or the opposite, and you get your exposure because it's cumulative. And it's important to think about using a dark control in these chambers, although cooling is an option that we didn't happen to get for this. That chamber gets at about 40 degrees, and so one would just put in additionally a sample covered with foil, and there's your dark control. So you could tease out any thermal effects if needed.